Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. As I mentioned to the children, today is Good Shepherd Sunday. The Sunday is when all of our readings focus on Jesus as the Good Shepherd and God as the Good Shepherd. This also happens to be the day in April when we celebrate Earth Day. And to help bring us into this space, I brought into the church some of the lovely plants that are cared for by Deborah from our 8:30 congregation. I was hoping that some greenery would help open up our imaginations a little bit and bring to mind the green pastures that the Lord, our Good Shepherd, has the power to lead us through. The image of God as a shepherd is very common in our scriptures for leaders of God's people. Moses was a shepherd prior to leading people through the Red Sea, which we sang about today. And King David was also known and remembered as one of the great kings of Israel. And he is known to be a shepherd as well. And this continues to this very day as your pastor, the title which you bestowed upon me, that word comes from the Latin, which has its connotations and background in the word shepherd. And we know that our bishops, when they come, they carry with them a shepherd's crook to remind us that they are shepherds of God's people. It's not just great leaders, however, who are described in Scripture as the shepherd, but the word is used to describe God himself. This description starts in our very first book of the Bible, in the book of Genesis, in chapter 48, verse 24, as Jacob on his deathbed summarizes his life, declaring that God has been his shepherd all the days to this very day of his life. The motif continues through the books of the law and the prophets who foretold of a great shepherd to come. And of course, through the Psalms, most notably Psalm 23, which we sang today. References to God as the shepherd will continue all throughout the New Testament, and they end in the book of Revelation in chapter 7, when the saints are brought before God and it is written that the Lamb in the center of the throne shall be their shepherd and shall guide them to the spring of the water of life, and God shall wipe away every tear from their eye. So when Jesus calls himself the Good Shepherd, he's calling to people's mind a very familiar image of a great leader and of God himself. And as he names himself in this way, he deliberately outlines why it is he thinks he deserves this title. He is willing to lay down his life for the sheep. He knows his sheep, and his sheep know him. The earliest image known of Jesus was found in a baptistry in an early 3rd century house in Dura Europus. It's the image of Jesus as a shepherd carrying a sheep across his shoulders. In the first few centuries of Christianity, the image of Jesus as a sheep, Jesus as a shepherd was one of the primary images of Christ. It wasn't until Christianity became a state-sponsored religion under Emperor Constantine, when the cross was banned as a method of torture, that the cross actually became a symbol. Prior to that, in the beginning of our faith, it was always Jesus as shepherd which dominated. And this image of Jesus as a shepherd carrying the sheep, it's on the front of the bulletin, it's a very iconic image to us. It brings to mind so many rich images of who it is that God is, who it is that Jesus is for us. For me, when I think of Jesus as the Good Shepherd, I always think first and foremost of the story of the lost lamb, the lost sheep. There were 100 sheep and one went missing. And the Good Shepherd went out and found that one. And when he found it, he laid it upon his shoulders and he rejoiced. This is also so much like the reference in Isaiah chapter 40 that says, like a shepherd, God will tend the flock. He will gather lambs in his arms and lift them to his lap. He will gently guide the nursing ewes. And I love this image because it conveys to us what we sang about this morning, that we are children of God. Small enough in God's eyes that we can be picked up and held in the loving embrace of our Heavenly Father. As Jesus was a shepherd to us, we know that he was also a fellow sheep, taking on our human nature and becoming one like us. And when he talks about laying down his life for us, we understand that this sacrifice was done on our behalf and for us. We're reading through the book of 1 John this Easter time in church. And in 1 John it states that the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. I think this is such an important image when we think of Jesus as the Lamb, because when we think of lambs, we often think of them as being small and fluffy and white. Jesus' death as the Lamb of God brings to mind another passage in the book of Isaiah, chapter 1, where God, despairing over his people, states, "Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be like snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool." Jesus, through his sacrifice, helps bring us to this place where we are made new again, washed from all of our sins, purified. And so now, looking at that, we can begin to see why this image of Jesus as a shepherd and us as lambs is so powerful. And it's so lovely to hold that image up as we are loved and cared for by God. And so I'm going to ask you to hold that image in just one hand. But we need to hold on to it in just one hand because though it speaks of the truth, it only speaks a part of the truth of who God is and what God calls us to be. It's not the whole picture. Because I think as lovely as it is to be understood as lambs of God and Jesus as our shepherd, lambs grow up to be sheep. And adult sheep aren't nearly as attractive as cute little lambs. And worse, sheep have a bad reputation for mindlessly following their leaders, lacking imagination and individuality. To be called a sheep by many is actually to be an insult. So we've got to hold that up. We've got to acknowledge that part too. Sheep have a herd mentality. They refuse to act independently. They like a team and find new things difficult. They're stubborn and willful. Sound like anyone? They're also very destructive. They love to eat, and if left to their own devices, would consume everything around them to satisfy their cravings and pose a very strong environmental challenge our world today. Again, it reminds us maybe of our own species here. Now, on the plus side, sheep are actually surprisingly intelligent. They have impressive memory and recognition skills. They're social animals who build friendships and stick up for each other in fights. And they feel sad when their friends accept a slaughter. But perhaps the biggest difference between us and sheep, our sheep do not have the intelligence or free will to step in, to sacrifice themselves for one another. Nor do they have the ability to stop their need to just consume. We humans, on the other hand, can. We are not called by God simply to be lambs our whole life, dependent, passive followers. Nor are we called to grow up to become sheep. Many times in our Christian faith, we hold up the passage from John 3:16 as the core of our Christian message. You know it, so you can say it with me. "For God so loved the world that he sent his only Son to save it." But do any of you know 1 John 3:16? To understand that message, I think we need to compare 3:16 of John with 1 John 3:16, which we heard read today. We know this. We know love by this, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. And then John Hill, in his commentary on this text, writes, "When we learn to see ourselves not just as beneficiaries of his suffering, but as sheep of his flock, we see that our salvation is in our relationship with him. Salvation is following where he leads and doing what he does. Salvation is to clean us from our sins, but that's not the only thing, because we don't all just want to revert back to being pure, white, cuddly lambs who need to be taken care of all the time. Jesus has come to do so much more. He has come to empower us and to enlighten our understandings about who we are and who God is in a holy way. Theologian David Lowes reminds us that Jesus in John's Gospel is the revealer, the one who comes to make the invisible God visible and the unapproachable God approachable. Jesus comes to reveal that God loves the whole world with no exceptions. So we know whether we're pure, blameless little lambs or big, dirty sheep, Jesus loves us all. And in turn, we are then invited alongside, not just to passively follow and be cared for, but to lead and to care for others, loving others, and laying aside our own lives like he did. And the self-sacrifice will not always call for our death, but it will call for the death of some of our bad habits, and it may ask us to sacrifice some of our conveniences for the greater good. And so this is how we tie it back into Earth Day today. Because we know that God didn't just create us and love us, but God created the world and loved the world. For when we were first created and made, God actually made us with the express purpose that we would care for the earth and all that was in it. When we think about this, we realize that we were created from the very start not to be sheep, but to be shepherds. As we follow in the example of Jesus, we lead others. Not just those of us in ministry who might have the titles or the crooks, but all of us. And as we all put on that mantle and take the mantle of the shepherd, we become more conscientious about the world around us. And as we become more conscientious, we become more connected. More connected to God, more connected to each other, and more connected to the world. As we celebrate Earth Day here at St. Bede's, let us start small by being aware of our needs to become more conscientious and connected. And one of the small ways that we can start doing that is just looking around our building and finding ways. Is there other small ways that we can do more and care for the earth and for each other in this place at this time? And in the bulletin today, there's also a handout that lists some suggestions from the Diocesan Environmental Working Group of things that we could also do in our homes and in here in the parish that we could do to have a lighter footstep and a lighter tread on the earth. Because we know that there are problems in it. It's not that normal to have an ice storm in April one week and then be plus 15 the next. So we need to take seriously the call that is out there and work towards that. And by doing so, I believe that we will be better followers of Jesus' example, our great shepherd, and we will be making the world a better place for all the other lambs and sheep that are in it. Thanks be to God.